Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to change the narrative around marriage and family to create a cultural climate favorable to lifelong married love. We also seek to promote recovery and healing from the wounds of the sexual revolution and share our stories with the next generation. I encourage you to visit our website, where you can sign up for our free e-newsletter and receive more information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J is once again Sheila Logmina's guest on A Closer Look. They're discussing the current attempt by the Wingards Institute to alter church teaching on contraception with a presentation before the United Nations. This attempt is not going unresponded to by Humanae Vitae Catholics, however.
Today, another campaign of dissent against church teaching was launched. And unlike last week's national newspaper ad campaign by the group called Catholics for Choice, this one was delivered at the United Nations. But Catholic scholars and academics were well prepared. I'm Sheila Logminas. Right now, it's 5 minutes after the hour. Time to take a closer look. This one was launched at the UN, United Nations, by the Wingard Institute. And Wingard's statement was put out today challenging the church to change its teachings on contraception and sexuality. Well, there were scholars and academics well aware this was coming out today and well prepared for it. Mary Rice Hassan, a fellow at the Ethics and Public Policy Center, just joined me in the first part of the program today to talk about that statement. I have got posted online today for you. So just go to the show page, either at relevantradio.com, my show page for A Closer Look, or on, better yet, if you can get to the Facebook show page for A Closer Look. First of all, click like, so you get these in your newsfeed all the time, everything I post for you. And then click share. Click share so that we can move this through the grassroots of the people who are already actively engaged and want to be engaged and they want to know the latest, because then they'll have a copy of this affirmation of the church's teaching on the gift of sexuality, signed by 500 theologians, academics, scholars. There are so many. I had no idea there would be 500 on the day it got launched, but it came out today. And more and more and more people are going to sign on as time goes on. Well, one of those signers who actually wrote an article in advance and published it because all of this was coming down today is joining me now. That's Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. What does the Ruth Institute do? Aspires to become the best in the world at inspiring and equipping the survivors of the sexual revolution to share their stories with the next generation and help them avoid the mistakes and challenge the ideologies from the previous generation of sexual revolutionaries. I like how she put that. She has an article out in The Blaze on this newest dissent campaign by the Wingards Institute. And also she's in that article addressing Pope Paul VI's Humanae Vitae and how prophetic that was and remains today. Jennifer, welcome back. Great to have you here today.
Hi, Sheila. Thanks for having me on.
It's great to have you. So, Jennifer, let's talk about this. Last week, it was a national ad campaign in newspapers across the country by the group calling themselves Catholics for Choice and claiming that public funding for abortion is a Catholic social justice value. Quote, unquote, that was their statement. This week now, this new Wingard statement at the United Nations challenging the church to change her teaching on contraception and sexuality. Jennifer, you've been in this battle on those very issues for a very long time now, knowing how prophetic Humanae Vitae was and having tons of documented evidence of the damage it has wrought, the sexual revolution has wrought. So talk about your thoughts on this. Are you surprised by this statement by the Wingard Institute?
Well, I have to say it took us a little bit by surprise that a bunch of people would, you know, would sort of raise their flag and say that the church should change its teaching. The Catholics for Choice people, you know, anybody who's paying attention knows that they're not really Catholic, and I'm happy to say that a number of bishops around the country, you know, kind of, if that advertisement ran in their paper, in their local paper, they spoke out about it and straightened out the situation, you know, and said very clearly, this is not Catholic teaching. So there were several bishops who did that, which I give them a lot of credit for. But but the Wingard Institute is evidently a British organization named after a guy who was a used to be a priest. I don't know whether he got kicked out or he left or whatever. But anyway, he used to be a priest. So Wingard is his name, and he calls his organization the Wingard Institute for Catholic Teaching. You know, and it's like, you know, please. It's not. I mean, they've got, if you look at their webpage, they've got the whole laundry list of 70s dissenting things. And one of their signers of their little petition is Charles Curran, for goodness sake, you know. So it's kind of like the same old, and the thing that bothered me about it is that they're being sponsored at the United Nations by some of the organizations that are the biggest purveyors of population control around the world, you know. And so this is exactly the thing that Pope Paul VI warned against. Pope Paul VI, in the very famous paragraph of Humanae Vitae where he predicted what would happen, one of the things he predicted was that if this gets into the hands of governments, they're going to force people to do it. It's not just going to be they're going to let you do it. They're going to let you do it. They're going to make you do it. And so that's what my column was really about last week. It's still posted up there on the Blaze. If you put my name in the search bar, it'll come up.
Jenny, I also posted it on the show page, so it's really easy people to go to. You just go get it off the show page. Dr. Jennifer Roback Morris, The Blaze article, Why the Prophetic Voice of Pope Paul VI Still Matters. It always will, Jennifer. It's as relevant now as it was then, and maybe more so because you can speak very well to what the sexual revolution wrought, because the Ruth Institute has worked so much for those who survived.
That's exactly right. That's exactly. And contraception is really at the heart of it, and a lot of people don't want to face up to that, but every day that goes by, it becomes harder and harder to avoid that. And it isn't just that the contraception is sitting on the shelf and people are legally allowed to purchase it. That's not what the Catholic Church is upset about, and that has never been enough for the true ideologues. The true sexual revolutionaries have never been satisfied with merely allowing the stuff to be legal. They have always been about promoting it and pushing it and subsidizing it and ultimately forcing it on people. And that's what people don't understand. That's the ideology. You know, there's a whole ideology around it. A whole package which is saying, you know, you're entitled to have as much sex as you want without a live baby ever showing up. That's the version of it we see in the West. But in other countries, the version that they see is you have to have a permit in order to have a child. You know, that's what China is doing with birth control, you know, and what India is doing with birth control is having sterilization camps. Where people, where women are essentially paid to have a tubal ligation, and one of those camps were just today I saw an article, and I have it on my on the Ruth Institute Facebook page, that there was a court ruling saying, you know, we've got to do something about these sterilization camps because the women are basically being bribed, they're not being properly informed about the risks and the dangers, the sanitation conditions are terrible. And this has got to stop. And this is going on today. Today, it is still going on. These are grotesque human rights violations. And nobody outside the Catholic Church is saying anything about it. You know, I mean, I'm sure there are a few people who are not Catholic who are saying, I don't want to overstate it. But I think everybody in the field knows that the principal voices that are consistently speaking out against it are Catholic voices. And that's why these old people, and they really are old, these people at the Wimsgaard Institute, these guys allowing themselves to be mouthpieces for the UN's ideology, it's gross. You know, really, it's gross. They're basically putting protective covering over this type of stuff that's going on all around the Third World.
And in fact, I'll get right back to that. Your reference to what's going on through the United Nations, different arms and wings, because that's happening all the time. But I want to bring up a remark a caller made, Jenny, because I think it's really an important one to bring up. It hits a couple of points you've made when you bring up who but the Church is saying this in the world. Who's even aware of this? And you're right. One of my issues all the time is think outside the borders. I mean, I just got back from recently a capital inside the capital itself. It was a conference on in defense of Christians and genocide, and over 30 members of Congress addressed the group about mass atrocities against Christians and other religious minorities. So all of these things we have to bring to the awareness of the people. But the caller called in on this topic we're talking about right now, the dissent against church teachings. A lot of people aren't even aware really what, if somebody stopped you and said, stopped a lot of people, what does the church teach on contraception and on matters of sexuality and homosexuality and this and that, people cohabitating and so forth. Some people might not be able to state that so clearly. This caller called in, Jenny, and when you brought up many good bishops have spoken out about last week's newspaper ad campaign by Catholics, a group calling themselves Catholics for Choice, and now the Wingard statement has so many hundreds of signatures by Catholic academics and scholars. The caller said this, that even though these fine bishops have commented, and Cardinal Timothy Dolan issued a statement through the USCCB about this dissent, he said, this caller said that the bishops have commented, we're commenting, but that people don't know, and we need to go outside even our own Catholic media. So when listeners right now across the country listening to us learn all of the things they learn, I'm always urging them, Jennifer, to engage out there in their circles and especially reach the people, yeah, fellow Catholics, but people who aren't going to hear this anywhere else, because they're not.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. You know, I was at a conference in Phoenix this past weekend. Bishop Olmsted had me out for one of his events on Catholics in the public square. He's a great, he's a wonderful bishop, and they get a lot of good things done in Arizona. And one of the things I said to the audience is that most of the time I talk to religiously mixed audiences, not just Catholic audiences, because the Catholic teaching on human sexuality is so good, we have no right to keep it to ourselves. And that audience burst into applause because they knew what I meant. But that's a fact that it's mm-hmm. like a secret. You know, what are we keeping a secret for? You know, people need to know this. People need to know and deserve to know this information, that the reason contraception is wrong is because it's separating the procreative from the unitive and the aspects of the sexual act, and is changing the nature of the sexual act. The sexual act by its nature is designed by God to bring two human persons together in a full communion of body and soul, a one flesh union of body and soul, for them to build up their relationship as husband and wife. That's why it's always been traditionally called a marital act, because it's supposed to be a marital act of complete self-giving, not something you do on a Saturday night rather than go bowling. It's supposed to be something complete of self-giving, and it's open to new life. So that act is a community-building, family-building act, that you're building the marriage by loving one another exclusively, and you're open to the possibility that you'll have a child, and you're building up the family in that way. And so all of those parts of human sexuality build together, the physiological, the biological, the emotional, the spiritual, all of them work together when you get married and stay married and have sex only with the person you're married to, and you're always open to life. Okay, that is a very simple kind of umbrella that integrates all of that. And what we've done in modern times is to take all of those pieces and chop them up. So I can have sex with somebody I'm not married to. I can have a baby without having sex. I can go to the lab and purchase a gamete that I don't have, because no person can make a baby by themselves, you know. So instead of having a love relationship, I'll go make a purchase. We've separated all of these aspects. And so the person who's harmed the most by it is the child. The child deserves a loving relationship between their parents, and who deserves a relationship with both of their parents. And it's the marital act that guarantees all of that, or that preserves it or protects it. And that's why the church is in favor of it. And that's what, you know, when we look around ourselves now, we can see every one of those things that should be unified, they've been torn apart and scattered, you know, and it's making people crazy.
And it's damaging society, and there's a lot to talk about, so I want more time on the other side of the break, and especially some of the work you've done through the Ruth Institute to pay attention when nobody else was to the children, to how the children are being damaged, what's happening to the children. Then you started another. You're always impressing me with starting new initiatives, and initiatives on the survivors of the sexual revolution. I thought that's a good one. And so you're eminently qualified to talk about this. You've got a lot of documentation, and you've got personal stories you can tell. What you were just describing there, you know, in each of those areas was the commodification of human life. And that's what's happened, that was prophetically foretold by Paul VI. And that's what Jennifer Roback Morris's article in The Blaze that I have posted online addresses it today. When she posted that last week, it is saying Pope Paul VI still matters today. And what he said in Humanae Vitae, she and I will talk about that after the break, and some of the initiatives the Ruth Institute's got going, but how she can explain what she just said, draw it out a little bit more, and the effects on children in our society. Jennifer, we have a call. Matt's calling in from Madison. I'm going to take this and see what his question is. Matt, go ahead.
Hello. I'm kind of wondering if this sort of touches on what you were just talking about with the marital act being both unitive and procreative. I wonder if the fact that we focus so much on the unitive aspect of sexual intercourse that we forget about, you know, the primary end, which is procreative, and if all of the discussion about the unitive doesn't somewhat allow Catholics to see the procreative as just a secondary portion of what intimacy is.
Jennifer, your thoughts on that? Because I heard you, Jennifer, put them together, unitive and procreative.
Yes, I usually put them together. But Matt, I'm just wondering, where are you hearing people only talk about the, or primarily talk about the unitive?
It happens a lot among my social friends, you know, that are what I would call Catholic light. You know, We kind of talk about it because we have a large family. We've got 10 kids, and most of our friends have one or two. And so then they ask you, why do you have 10 kids? I said, well,
people are like that, aren't they?
And that sort of leads into that discussion. And a lot of people are stunned. They're just like, well, you know, we were really only taught about the unitive portion, and we can decide on the procreative portion.
Oh, I see what you mean.
That's the clinch.
See, right there, Matt, that's exactly what Paul VI was trying to get away from. That's what has been developed further since Humanae Vitae.
Mm-hmm.
A number of scholars have written about this, and of course, St. John Paul II, I love calling him that, St. John Paul II, developed it even further with the theology of the body, that it's not up to us to decide whether any particular act will be procreative or not. And so it sounds like your friends there were poorly catechized. Is that what you? It seems like the thing for you to say, if they say to you, "Why do you have so many children?" Maybe you should say to them, "Why do you not have so many children?" I mean, do you not know how this works, or what? I mean, you know, you could have a little fun with them. I'm sure you do at some point, right? Don't you poke fun at them a little bit?
We do, but it's something that I think that inherently people know in their heart what they're doing, and they don't like having that particular aspect of their relationship, you know, talked about. So I just wonder
Hold on a second, Matt. If they're blasting you with the fact that they're contracepting, they are kind of making it public. You know what I mean? I feel like the your best strategy is not necessarily to be arguing with these people, but I don't know whether poke fun at them is the right word, but show to them that this is a life of joy and that this is a lifestyle of joy and pleasure and that they're missing something. I mean, you know, give them something to long for. And I can tell you that I know a lot of women who, like me, you know, who have advanced degrees and who have careers and so on and so forth, we don't have nearly as many children as we wish we could have had because we spent all those years contracepting. You know, and then we're finally socially ready for it or economically ready for it or whatever. And then you can't have the kids that you want. And so, I always like to tell young people, you know, you need to get on with it. If you're 20, if you're in your mid 20s and you're happily married, you need to get on with it and quit worrying about whether you're ready. You know what I mean?
I'm going to jump in here. Matt, I think that's this, like Jennifer said, when you respond back to your friends, this provides you an opportunity. When they bring these things up, it sounds like you're having conversations about the church teaching and the unitive and the procreative. But when they the clincher that you said was that they put the emphasis on the unitive. This is precisely, as Jennifer said, what Paul VI predicted. And without the procreative, this gives you an opportunity. I mean, just to witness to the beauty of the large family, to grow, what it was like to grow up in a large family. And by the way, this is what the church means in her teaching, the very teaching that Wingard's statement today wants the church to change. Church isn't going to change it, but that's a great way to witness. And young people, particularly, Matt, aren't your group and others listening right now, aren't even schooled, educated, or catechized in this so well to even know that that's the truth of the church teaching. So it becomes a teaching moment and a witness moment.
Yeah. Now, let me mention, if I may, Sheila, that we have a petition going that is basically a petition to the United Nations to tell them to stop giving a platform to these dissenting Catholic organizations. And so we just put it up a little bit earlier today, and people can find that on the Ruth Institute Facebook page. So help. And we have a little image on there that makes me laugh. It's a picture of Pope Paul VI. And you know how kids make these memes that are on Facebook and everything? Mm-hmm. There's a picture of Pope Paul VI looking, he's sort of friendly with his little hand up there, you know, and it says on the top, Humanae Vitae, and on the bottom it says, I told you so. That's kind of our message to the world there.
You know, to that point, Jennifer, in your Blaze article, The Blaze, Why the Prophetic Voice of Pope Paul VI Still Matters, I've got it on the show page today, about four paragraphs down, you say this, in paragraph 17 of Humanae Vitae, called Consequences of Artificial Methods, Pope Paul VI makes a series of predictions, period. Then you say, all of them have come to pass. You just declare it. All of his predictions have come to pass. Yep. And they have. We're under a minute, but I just wanted to throw that in there when you said on your Facebook page, Paul VI's face saying, see, I told you so. Because they all have come to pass.
Yes, yes. And see, the irony of these dissenters going to the UN is that they're proving Paul VI's point. The UN population controllers are looking for moral sanction to keep doing what they're doing. And we're not going to give it to them. We're not going to give it to them.
Going to call them out. That's exactly what's happened with this wonderful statement I posted by all these scholars and academics. Affirmation of Church's Teaching on the Gift of Sexuality. I've got it on the show page. Jennifer, thank you so much for being here today. Wonderful.
You've just been listening to Dr. J and Sheila Lagminas discussing dissent to the teachings of the Catholic Church on contraception, as put before the United Nations by the Wingard's Institute. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Roback Moore's pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes, and as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love and healing within the family.